In the last video, we talked about the detailed analysis of JEE Advanced 2020 paper 1. And then some of the students requested, sir, please upload the solution for paper 2 also. So here we go. The purpose of creating this video is to provide some understanding on what kind of questions you can expect in this particular examination, what are the various problem solving strategies, how to attack the question, and if there are multiple ways to solve a question, how to find out which is the best possible approach in the real examination situation. Now, these are some of the issues which we are going to deal with in this particular video. If I go with the topic-wise analysis, in algebra sections, there were 7 questions which were asked from the topics complex number, probability, matrices, binomial theorem, permutation and combination. Here, you would notice one thing is, there were 2 questions from probability and 2 questions from permutation combination, which are relatively small chapters. And what I have seen is many students have got phobia towards these 2 chapters. And maybe because the topics require a lot of involved thinking, lot of deep understanding is required. And perhaps the examiner also may be knowing about it, and that's why he has set up 4 questions from these 2 topics. Coming on to calculus, the questions were mainly asked from functions, limits, continuity and differentiability, integration and differential equation. In trigonometry sections, there was just 1 question. Now here also many students feel that since the number of questions in trigonometry are relatively very few, maybe some paper you will find 2 questions, not more than that. So they don't prepare it so thoroughly. But here I would like to say one thing is, the concept of trigonometry are actually required in lot of problems from calculus and other topics also. So don't ignore this topic. This is a very important topic which you should prepare it very thoroughly. Then we had questions from quadrant geometry in circle and hyperbola chapter. There were 2 questions, one from vector and one from 3D geometry also. So this was about the topic wise analysis of the questions. The students who are there in 9th and 10th may also find it very useful, because they will at least get to know what kind of paper pattern is there, what kind of problems comes in the exam, how to deal with the questions. And watch this video till the very end, only then you will get to know the deep insight of the problem solving. If you like this video, share with your friends and don't forget to subscribe our channel. And now we will be going one by one problem solving approaches. We will do all the questions which were asked for this particular exam one by one. Okay, so let's take the first problem of JEE Advanced 2020 paper 2, which is based on the complex number. A very interesting thought provoking question with good number of concept. The question says, for a complex number z, let rez denote the real part of z and let s be the set of complex number satisfying z to the power 4 minus modulus of z to the power 4 is equal to 4 iota z square, where iota is equal to square root of minus 1, then the minimum possible value of modulus of z1 minus z2 whole square, where z1 and z2 belong to the set S with real part of z1 greater than 0 and real part of z2 less than 0 is. Now here the first thing which we need to understand is, in this question he is saying that there is a set S. This set S contains all those complex numbers which satisfy this given equation. Secondly, he is asking us to find out the minimum value of modulus of z1 minus z2 whole square, and here z1 and z2 are those in the set S satisfying this equation. So what we need to understand is, what does this z1 minus z2 modulus represent? It represents the distance between the complex number z1 and z2 in the Argand plane. So this is one point which we will be using it to solve this particular question. Secondly, in this equation he has used mod of z raised to the power 4. So wherever in any complex equation you get mod of z square or mod of z to the power 4, what you write is, instead of mod of z square you can write z into z conjugate. So this also we will be using it to solve this question. So let's take this equation, which is z raised to the power 4 minus this
modulus of z raised to the power 4, I am writing it as mod of z square square. This is equal to what? 4 iota z square. Now here, this mod of z square, if I write it as square of z into z conjugate, square of z into z conjugate is equal to 4 iota z square. So what I can do here is, assuming that z not equal to 0, first of all z equal to 0 is satisfying this equation. So z equal to 0 can also be the part of the set S which is satisfying this equation. Now for time being, to start with, I will just assume that z is not equal to 0. And suppose if z is not equal to 0, I can cancel this z square in both the sides of this equation. So if I cancel this z square here, I will get z square minus z conjugate square is equal to 4 iota. Now the moment I see this z square minus z conjugate square, I can factorize the left hand side as z plus z conjugate multiplied by z minus z conjugate. This is equal to 4 iota. This 4 iota I can take it on the left hand side in such a way that I can write z plus z conjugate upon 2. What is this value? This is nothing but the real part of z. And z minus z conjugate upon 2 iota, what is this? This is the imaginary part of z. So this becomes 2 into 2 i is 4 i, which is divided in both the sides. So right hand side becomes equal to 1. Now here z plus z conjugate divided by 2 represent nothing but the real part of z. So this becomes real part of z and this becomes imaginary part of z, which is equal to 1. Now suppose if the complex number is of the form x plus iota y, what this equation would represent is x multiplied by y is equal to 1. Now here there are two ways to approach the same question after this. What I can do is, the conventional way is, I will write, say I have the two complex number z1 and z2, so I will take the first complex number z1 as x1 plus iota y1 and secondly z2 as x2 plus iota y2. And then if I take this condition z1 minus z2 whole square, and if I club it with this, and then if I use the am gm inequality, I would get the required condition, which is for satisfying this condition, and then the value of mod of z1 minus z2 whole square, this I can get that. This is one way of doing it. Is now the second way, which is more convenient way, if you think in terms of coordinate geometry, the moment you see x into y equal to 1, what comes to your mind? It is rectangular hyperbola, a rectangular hyperbola with the asymptotes on x and y axis. So our hyperbola will actually be formed like this. This is our, say, y axis, this is the x axis. So x into y equal to 1 would be a rectangular hyperbola like this, correct? Now here, if you read the question very carefully, he has said real part of z1 is positive and this rectangular hyperbola has two arms. If real part of z is positive, obviously the imaginary part is also positive because x into y is positive. So our rectangular hyperbola will have this part, z1 will form the first quadrant part of the rectangular hyperbola. This means z1 must lie on this region, which is in the first quadrant of the rectangular hyperbola. And where does z2 lie? He says z2, real part of z2 is less than 0. If real part of z2 is less than 0, imaginary part is also less than 0. So this arm, okay, in the third quadrant, would your z2 will lie somewhere on this particular arm. Now, I need to find out those two points. As I told you, this z1 minus z2 modulus whole square, represents the distance between the two complex number z1 and z2. So what I need to find out is the minimum possible value. Minimum possible value means I need to locate the two complex numbers on this rectangular hyperbola such that the distance between those two points should be minimum. And you can see that one point is on this arm, another point is on this arm. then and in what condition the distance between any two point on these two sides of the rectangular hyperbola will be minimum. It is possible only when the two points intersect the axis of the hyperbola. So what is the axis of this rectangular hyperbola? It will be, the axis of this rectangular hyperbola will be nothing but the line y equal to x. So let's say this is the line y equal to x. So the two complex number will be lying on these two point of intersection. So this would be our complex number z1, this is our complex number z2. And what are the coordinates of this point? Obviously, because this is line is y equal to x, if I put y equal to x over here, I get x square equal to 1, that means x equal to plus minus 1. So when x is equal to 1, y equal to 1 corresponding to this point. When x equal to minus 1, y equal to minus 1, that means this corresponds to this point minus 1 comma minus 1. Now the question is asking us to find out modulus of z1 minus z2 whole square, that is z1 minus z2 whole square is nothing but the distance between the point z1 and z2 square. Now using the distance formula, I can say square root of 1 plus 1 whole square plus 1 plus 1 whole square, and the square of this value, because this z1 minus z2 is this value, and the square of this value, that means it is nothing but 2 square is 4 and 4 plus 4 is 8, and this root and square will get cancelled out. You will get 8 as the value of z1 minus z2 modulus whole square. So as per the question, the minimum possible value of modulus of z1 minus z2 whole square satisfying all these condition is equal to 8. So 8 will be the right answer to this question. Let's take this problem from binomial distribution, which has been asked in JEE Advanced 2020 paper 2, and the question is the probability that a missile hits the target successfully is 0.75. In order to destroy the target completely, at least 3 successful hits are required. Then the minimum number of missiles that have to be fired so that the probability of destroying the target is not less than 0.95 is. This means in the question he has provided us two information. The first information is if the missile has to hit the target successfully, the probability of successful firing is 0.75. The second information which he gives us in the question is to completely destroy the target, it requires minimum 3 successful target. Based on these two information, what he is asking us is the number of trials, the minimum number of trials, the value of n for which what happens, the probability of completely destroying the target is not less than 0.95, means that probability should be greater than or equal to 0.95. this is what he is asking us in this question. So it's a very pretty straightforward and very standard question which uses the concept of binomial distribution, wherein what we say is the out of the n given trial, if we want exactly r successes, that means the probability of having exactly r successes, if x is the number of success, if the number of successes is equal to r, then that probability is given by ncr p to the power r q to the power n minus r, where p is the probability of success, and in our case this probability is 0.75, or I can say p is equal to 3/4. If p is equal to 3/4, q is the probability of failure. So q becomes equal to 1 minus 3/4, which is equal to 1/4. Okay. So p and q, that is known to us. Now what we need to find out is the minimum value of n for which the probability of completely destroying the target is not less than 0.95. So what we can do is, first we will say probability that the missile hits the three number of times there will be a successful hit out of the n given hits. That is our favorable case. So we will write probability that the missile will have exactly 3 successes. Okay. Or anything more than 3 is also favorable out of the n given case. So probability that x is equal to 4 is also successes. That means 4 hits. 5 hits is also favorable. Like that, your x value can keep going on till the n. All are our favorable cases. Okay, now this value, probability of this value should be greater than or equal to 0.95. so what does it mean is, if I take like this, or if I put up the same information as this is the total probability of success, if I subtract 1 minus probability of failure, it will come out to be the same thing. Now what values are not there in this is x is equal to 0, x equal to 1, x equal to 2. So these combined together, this will be the probability of failure. So I can say 1 minus, this is 1 minus the probability that there is no hit, that is x is equal to 0, probability that there is exactly 1 hit, or the probability that there are 2 hits. So this bracket denotes the total probability of failure, because the missile is firing less than 3 times, so it will not destroy the target. So 1 minus the unfavorable probability will give us the total favorable probability, and this value should be greater than or equal to 0.95. Now what I do is, I will take this 0.95 on the left hand side, so I get 1 minus 0.95, and this entire bracket can come on the right hand side. So this value should be greater than or equal to probability that x is equal to 0, or the probability that x is equal to 1, or the probability that x is equal to 2. Correct. Now here 1 minus 0.95 is 0.05. this value should be greater than or equal to probability that x is equal to 0. Means here I can put r equal to 0 in this formula, so I get nc0. What is the value of p? The value of p in this case is 3/4. So this is 3/4 raised to the power 0 multiplied by 3/4 raised to the power, sorry, this is 1/4, because 1 minus 3/4 is q to the power n minus r. So n minus 0, which is equal to n, plus this becomes nc1 multiplied by, what is the value of p? It is 3/4 raised to the power 1 into 1/4 raised to the power n minus 1. When x is equal to 2, I will write nc2 into 3/4 raised to the power 2 into 1/4 raised to the power n minus 2. Correct. Now if I take if I simplify this bracket, nc0 is 1, 3/4 to the power 0 is also equal to 1, and this is 1/4 raised to the power n, this is 1/4 to the power n. Nc1 is equal to n multiplied by, numerator is 3 and the denominator becomes 4 to the power n minus 1 into 4, that is 4 to the power n. And here nc2 is n into n minus 1 divided by 2, and 3 square is 9 divided by, this also becomes 4 to the power 2 into 4 to the power n minus 2, finally becomes 4 to the power n only. So this is 0.05. if I multiply by 2 into 4 to the power n in both the sides, so I get 0.05 into 2, which is 0.1 into 4 to the power n. The left hand side, this right hand side becomes 4 to the power n is cancelled out, this becomes 2 plus, this is 2 multiplied by 3, which is 6 into n, 4 to the power n is cancelled out, 4 into 4 to the power n is cancelled out from this term also. I get 9 times n into n minus 1, which is 9n square minus 9n. So finally what we get is 0.1 into 4 to the power n. 0.1 into 4 to the power n should be greater than or equal to, this becomes 9n square minus 3n plus 2. 9n square minus 3n plus 2. Okay, so all those values of n which are satisfying this inequality would come into my favorable cases. But here, as per the question, I should get the minimum value of n, the minimum number of missiles that would be fired. So the value of n the value of n should be such that it should be minimum value which should satisfy this particular inequality. So what I will do is I will start from n equal to 3, because minimum 3 successful hits have to be necessary. So we will take n equal to 3. So I will just keep putting up the value of n in this particular inequality. What the inequality says, I am writing it here, 0.1 multiplied by 4 to the power n should be greater than or equal to 9n square minus 3n plus 2. So here if I put, say, n is equal to 3, so what I get over here, n equal to 3, so this becomes for n equal to 3, for n is equal to 3, what I get is 0.1 into 4 to the power 3 is 4 to the power 3 is 64, should be greater than 3, 3 is a 9, into 9 is 81, minus 3 into 3 is 9 plus 2. So my 6.4 should be greater than or equal to 72 plus 2 is 73. So this is not satisfying, correct? Then I will put n is equal to 4. So n is equal to 4 if I take. So what this becomes is 0.1 into 4 raised to the power 4. So 4 to the power 4 is 256. So this becomes 25.6. This should be greater than or equal to 16 into 9, which is 144, minus 12 plus 2. So clearly this value left hand side is greater than the right hand side. No, it is not there. So this is also not satisfying our inequality. Then I put n is equal to 5. So for n is equal to 5, what will happen? I will write 4 to the power 5, which is 102.4. So this becomes 102.4 should be greater than or equal to, if I put n equal to 4 on the right hand side, this becomes 25 into 9, which is 225, minus 15 plus 2, though this is 213, which is definitely not greater than this value. So this is also not satisfying. Finally, I put n is equal to 6. So when we put n equal to 6, what we get is 4 raised to the power 6, which is 4096 into 0.1, which is 409.6, should be greater than or equal to, I am putting here what, n is equal to 6 in both the sides. So what would be my right hand side is 6 into 6 is 36, and 36 multiplied by 9, what I get is this becomes 324. So I will get 324 minus, putting 6 here, to 18, so minus of 18 plus 2. So 324 minus 18 will become 306 plus 2, 308. So definitely 409.6 is greater than 308 is satisfying this inequality. So n equal to 6 is the right answer to this question. So the correct answer is n equal to 6. So we will take this problem from Circle, which has been asked in JEE Advanced 2020 paper 2. The question says, let O be the center of the circle x square plus y square equal to r square, where r is greater than root 5 by 2. Suppose PQ is the chord of this circle and the equation of the line passing through P and Q is 2x plus 4y equal to 5. If the center of the circumcircle of the triangle OPQ lies in the line x plus 2y is equal to 4, then value of r is. Now what happens in this question, they have given us a standard circle x square plus y square equal to r square with the center as origin. So first I will draw a circle something like this. So say this is, say, some circle, okay. Now here this circle, I will assume thus O be the center of this circle, which is having the coordinate as origin, okay. In this circle we have a chord PQ. So what I will do is I will draw a chord PQ on this circle. So I have drawn a chord, say this is the chord PQ on this circle, okay. And the equation of the line passing through P and Q is 2x plus 4y equal to 5. So this line is only having the equation, this 2x plus 4y equal to 5 is the equation of our PQ chord only. if the center of the circumcircle OPQ, now let us first we make the triangle OPQ. So if I take this triangle OPQ, now what the question is saying, if the center of the circumcircle of the triangle OPQ. So circumcircle of the triangle OPQ may go something like this. It will go say like this. This is the circumcircle of the triangle OPQ. Now what the question is saying, the center of the circumcircle. So if this is the circumcircle, then the center of the circumcircle lies on the line x plus 2y is equal to 4. Now if you carefully observe this line and this line, both these lines are parallel. That means this line, the diameter of this line would be parallel to the line PQ, correct? Because the center of the circumcircle lies on this line. So this line PQ and the bigger circle diameter will be parallel to each other. So this would go say something like this. Now here I can use lot of geometrical result. What I will do is, if I draw a perpendicular from the center on the chord PQ, that perpendicular will bisect the chord first of all. And if I extend this perpendicular to here, so this and this, both these angles will be equal to 90 degrees. Another important thing is, if I take this triangle OPQ and say this is the point C, which is the circumcenter of the triangle OPQ. If C is the circumcenter of the triangle OPQ, then the distance of this circumcenter from all the three vertices will be equal. That means the distance from C to O will be equal to the distance from C to P. This is one important result which we will be using to solve this particular problem. Now here, let us first find out some distances. Say this is the point M. What is the distance from O to M? That we can easily find out using the formula of distance of a line from the origin. The line PQ and the origin O will be given by the distance OM. So what is this OM? OM will be equal to 5 upon square root of coefficient of x, which is 2, so square of 2, which is 4, plus coefficient of y is 4 over here, so plus 16. So this gives me 5 divided by root 20. Root 20 can be written as 2 root 5. So this is the distance from O to M. Similarly, I can find out the distance from O to C, which is the distance from this line and the origin O. So the distance from O to C will be given by this line I am talking about, which is 4 divided by square root of 1 square plus 4 square, which is equal to square root of 1 plus 4, that is equal to 4 upon root 5. Now based on this, I can also find out the distance from C to M. So what is the distance from C to M? Distance CM will be given by distance OC minus OM. OC we already got 4 upon root 5 minus 5 upon 2 root 5. So to make the calculation easy, 4 upon root 5, I will write it as 8 upon 2 root 5. So 8 upon 2 root 5 minus 5 upon 2 root 5 will give me 3 upon 2 root 5. So this gives me the distance CM. Now here, if I take this right angle triangle, if I take this triangle, I am talking about the triangle PCM. This triangle, if we say, in this triangle, if I use the Pythagoras theorem, now the first thing which I said is the distance of this circumcenter from the three vertices are equal. So the distance from C to P will be equal to the distance from C to O. And what is the distance from C to O? Which is 4 upon root 5, which we have already calculated. Now, if I take the Pythagoras theorem in this triangle PCM, what I get is the hypotenuse PC square should be equal to the sum of the square of the other two sides, which is PM square plus MC square. Now, PC, we already got it. It is same as OC, which is 4 upon root 5. So, this is 4 upon root 5 square is equal to, this is root 5 square is equal to PM square. Now, what is PM square? This I need to find out. So, how will I find out the length PM? This I can make use of another right angle triangle. If I write, if I take the triangle POM. Now, observe very carefully. This is also a right angle triangle, correct? So, in this right angle triangle, what is PO? PO is nothing but the radius of this circle. So, PO is equal to R. Okay? So, if I take in triangle PMO, in triangle PMO, if I use the Pythagoras theorem, I will get PO square, that is R square, is equal to this length PM square plus OM square. Now, OM we have calculated as 5 upon 2 root 5. So, 5 upon 2 root 5 is nothing but root 5 by 2, correct? This will be root 5 by 2 square. So, our PM square becomes equal to R square minus 5 by 4. So, why I got that? Because I will be needing it in this calculation. So, what is PM? What is the value of PM square? PM square is R square minus 5 by 4. So, I will write it as R square minus 5 by 4 plus MC square. Now, what is the distance from M to C? That also we have calculated, which is 3 upon 2 root 5. So, I will write it as 3 upon 2 root 5 square. Okay. Remaining part calculation, I am doing it here. So, this becomes 16 divided by 5 is equal to R square minus 5 by 4 plus, this becomes 9 upon 4 root 5 square, means this will be 5 into 4, which is 20. So, this becomes 9 by 20. So, what is R square? R square, simply take the other terms on the left hand side. So, this gives me 16 by 5 plus 5 by 4 minus 9 by 20. So, here if you calculate the LCM is 100, 5, 4 and 20. So, 20 into 5 is 100 and 20 into 16 is 320 plus 25 into 4 is 100 and 25 into 5 is 125 minus 20 into 5 is 100 and 9 into 5 is 45. So, 125 minus 45 is 80, 80 plus 300 is 400. So, 400 by 100 is the value of R square, which is 4. So, if R square is equal to 4, you can clearly say that the value of R will be equal to 2, because R square equal to 4. So, R equal to 2 is the right answer to this question. So, students, the problem based on matrices which we are going to take now, if you solve it by a proper conventional way, it would take a very long time, lot of lengthy calculations will be involved. But the same question, if you use the trick which I am going to tell you now, you can do it in less than 1 minute without much calculation. So, before going ahead, let me just read out the question, which says that the trace of a square matrix is defined to be the sum of its diagonal entries. If A is a 2 by 2 matrix such that the trace of A is 3 and the trace of A cube is minus of 18, then the value of determinant of A is. This means what? First, he has defined what is the trace of a matrix, which we already know that it is the sum of its diagonal elements. Then he has considered a matrix A whose trace is equal to 3, and if I take the cube of that matrix and then I find out the trace, it is minus of 18. And then he is asking us to find out the determinant of A. Normally, in such kind of questions, what we generally tend to do is we consider a matrix A like A, B, C and D, and then we find out its trace, which is A plus D, which I say is equal to 3. Then I will take the cube of that matrix, for which first I'll take a square and multiply it again once more to find out A cube. That itself will take a lot of time, and then I will get some equation in terms of A, B, C, D. Solving it will again take too much of time. Now, instead of that, if I simply observe this question, first of all, the question is a single digit integer type of question. One thing. Secondly, in this question, he is asking us the determinant of that matrix. That means we are here not concerned about the individual values of A, B, C, D. So, if I construct a matrix which follows only the two restriction what is given in the question, what is that? First is that matrix should have the trace equal to 3, and the trace of its cube should be equal to minus of 18. Only these two restriction if I keep in my mind, and I can take any such matrix. So first thing is how to frame such a matrix. So let me consider the easiest matrix which require minimal calculation. So that would be like a diagonal matrix whose non-diagonal entries, if I take 0, 0. So if I take these two values 0 and 0, and these two values I can consider anything, like I can say x and y. Okay, let this be any such matrix. Now why I'm saying is the cube of any diagonal matrix, we know it is nothing but the cube of its diagonal entries, which is x cube and y cube, and other values are 0. We know the property of a diagonal matrix. Using that, I can say this is A cube. So here, as per the restriction which are given in the question, our x plus y is actually how much? It is 3. And what is x cube plus y cube? The trace of this matrix, it is equal to minus of 18. So from here, what I need? I need the determinant of this matrix. So what is the determinant of this matrix? Very obvious, it is equal to x into y. So I just need the value of x into y using these two equations, which is very easy to find out. I will simply take the calculation, x plus y whole cube is equal to x cube plus y cube plus 3 into x into y into x plus y. So x plus y whole cube is 27, 3 cube. X cube plus y cube, this is given to us minus of 18. 3 into xy, xy as such I need to find out, and x plus y is equal to 3. I can divide this entire equation by 9. So I get 3 is equal to minus 2 plus xy. Okay. So what is xy? Xy will be equal to 3 plus 2, which is equal to 5. What we need? We need xy only. So that is equal to 5 with our required answer. So see how fast we have done it without any much calculation. Here somebody may argue that if I find out x and y in this, if I find out x and y after solving it, then it would come out to be imaginary. So it doesn't matter, because the question is not asking us that x and y to be real. He has not written anywhere in this question that the matrix is having real entries, so it can be imaginary also. But the answer, whatever you get, would be independent upon the value of x and y. The x into y, well, this product will always be equal to 5, which is what he is asking for this particular question. So hope you must have enjoyed solving this question. The problem based on calculus which we are going to take now seems to be very lengthy, very complicated. But when you make use of some basic concepts on function, it comes out to be quite simple. So let's have a look on this question, which has the two functions f and g. The function f is having the domain from minus 1 to 1 codomain real set, and the function g has domain as well as codomain in the interval from minus 1 to 1. The function fx is defined by mod of 2x minus 1 plus modulus of 2x plus 1, and the function g of x is x minus greatest integer of x which means gx is the fractional part function of x. And then it talks about the function fog, which is the composite function f of gx. The question then says that c is the number of points in the interval from minus 1 to 1 where the composite function fog is not continuous, and d is the number of points in the open interval from minus 1 to 1 where the function fog is not differentiable, and we have to find out the value of c plus d. That means the number of points where fog is not continuous plus the number of points where fog is not differentiable we need to find. Now to start with, I will just have a look on this f of x, which is the sum of the two mod expression, and we know that modulus expression will change its definition when what is there inside the mod becomes zero. So here our critical point from these two mod will be x is equal to 1 by 2 and x is equal to minus 1 by 2. So we will redefine the function f of x as, when x is less than minus 1 by 2, it becomes minus 2x plus 1 minus 2x minus 1, which is equal to minus of 4x when x is less than minus 1 by 2. When x lies between minus 1 by 2 to 1 by 2, this becomes this 2x minus 1 is negative, 2x plus 1 is positive. So we have minus 2x plus 1 plus 2x plus 1, which is equal to 1 plus 1, that is 2, when x lies between minus 1 by 2 to plus 1 by 2. And when x is greater than 1 by 2, we have both the values positive. So 2x minus 1 plus 2x plus 1, which becomes equal to 4x when x is greater than 1 by 2. So if we try to plot the graph of fx, how it becomes is between minus 1 by 2 to plus 1 by 2, it takes the constant value as equal to 2, and when x is greater than 1 by 2, it is continuously increasing. So the graph becomes like this: minus 1 by 2 to 1 by 2, it's a constant value as 2. When x is greater than 1 by 2, it will be increasing. When x is less than minus 1 by 2, it would be decreasing, function like this. And we have to write this function fx only in the interval from minus 1 to 1. So say this is say minus 1 and this is say 1. So at both minus 1 and 1, if you see, the value of the function is equal to 4. So say this is say 4. So the function is actually only till here. So this is how is the function which we have between minus 1 and 1. Now let us see the other function g of x, which is a fractional part function, and we know that fractional part function is a periodic function whose graph goes like this, and the period of this fractional part function is equal to 1. Now I will make use of a very important property of the periodic function. If we have the function fog and if gx is a periodic function, means the inside function of the composite function is a periodic function, then fog is also periodic. That means we have here fog of x is f of gx, which is fractional part function of x. Now if this inside function, fractional part function, is periodic, then the whole function fog is also periodic with the same period what is there for the function fractional part function, which is equal to 1. So the period of fog is 1. That means whatever is happening from 0 to 1, the same thing will happen between minus 1 to 0 in the graph of fog. Okay. Secondly, we know that fractional part function of x between 0 to x is nothing but is equal to x only. So I can simply write this value as f of x for x between 0 to 1. Now between 0 to 1, this graph will be same, FOG graph will be same between 0 to 1, whatever is the graph, this we have drawn the graph of FX, same is the graph of FOG of X in the interval from 0 to 1. So if I want to plot the graph of say FOG of X, how it would actually look like? Say this is say X equal to 0, and here we have X is equal to say 1 by 2. Now, if you draw the graph, what we get is between 0 to 1, it is exactly same. So the function becomes like this between 0 to 1. So this is between 0 to 1. Between 0 to 1, the function is exactly same. Now, because the function is periodic, so whatever is happening between 0 to 1, same thing will happen between minus 1 to 0. So if I have this value as minus 1, this is minus 1 by 2. So what I get is exactly the same thing, means it comes out to be the exact replica. So what we get over here will be something like this. And here, if you see, the function will be having a discontinuity, you can clearly see. So when I draw the graph, I will have to lift my pen from here only at one point. So we need to find out the number of values of x where the function is not continuous. So clearly only at one point, x equal to 0, in the interval from minus 1 to 1, the function is not continuous, which is the value of c. So here we get the value of c is equal to 1. Now I need to find out the number of point where the function is not differentiable, and we know wherever the graph has sharp corner, like at x is equal to 1 by 2, x equal to 1 by 2 and x equal to minus 1 by 2, these are the two points where we get the sharp corner. So the function is not differentiable at these two points. Plus, whenever the function is not continuous, obviously there also the function is not differentiable. So the function will not be differentiable, you can see that at x is equal to 0. Now you can note that the graph is, the function is actually not defined at minus 1 and 1. So I cannot take consideration of minus 1 and 1 because we have been given the open interval minus 1 to 1. So you can see that the function is not differentiable at 3 points. So what I would write is the value of d will be equal to 3. At the 3 point, x is equal to minus 1 by 2, x equal to 0 and x equal to 1 by 2. These are the 3 points where the function is not differentiable. So c equal to 1, d equal to 3. What I get is the value of c plus d, which is equal to 1 plus 3 equal to 4. That means the answer to this question is 4 is the number of points where the function is not continuous plus not differentiable, c plus d is equal to 4. So that's how we solve this question. I hope you must have understood the logic and you must have enjoyed this question. The question could be made more challenging had the interval be, instead of minus 1 to 1, it has considered say some other interval. If I take say minus 100 to plus 100. So now, based on this logic, try to find out the value of c plus d when the function is defined in the interval say from minus 100 to 100, and write the answer in the comment box. I will surely revert back to it. Hope you must have enjoyed this question. We will now take this problem of limits, which has been asked in JEE Advanced 2020 paper 2, and in this question we need to evaluate the value of this limit when x is approaching to pi by 2. So when x approaches to pi by 2, what will happen to the numerator? The numerator comes out to be sine of 3 pi by 2 plus sine pi by 2, which is minus 1 plus 1. So numerator comes out to be 0. Similarly, you can check it when you put x is equal to pi by 2 in the denominator, the denominator also comes out to be 0. So the entire expression comes out to be 0 by 0 form. Now a very obvious thought, when you see 0 by 0 form, we can make use of L'Hospital rule. The only thing, when you are using the LH rule, you will not get the answer only by applying it once. You might have to do it multiple times. Now, what my observation says is, when you are using the LH rule several times, lengthy calculations are involved, so lot of students tend to make mistakes. Now, to avoid it, we can use an alternate method. Now, what is the key thought while doing it by this method is, you need to just identify the real culprit because of which you are getting 0 by 0 form. That means you have to find out something which is giving you 0 by 0 form in the numerator as well as the denominator. If somehow you can cancel that, automatically your expression comes out to be some finite form which can easily be evaluated. So that is what we are going to do in this question. So if you observe in the numerator, what we have is sin 3x plus sin x. Sin 3x can be written as 3 sin x minus 4 sin x, and this sin x can be clubbed with the 3 sin x. So you get in the numerator, you will have 4 sin x, because this is 3 sin x minus 4 sin cube x plus sin x will become 4 sin x minus 4 sin cube x. Now this 4 root 2 I will write as it is, and our limit when x is approaching to pi by 2, what will happen to the denominator? Here these root 2 plus root 2 cos 2x, in both of them I can take out root 2 as common. So what I get is root 2 into 1 plus cos 2x, which is root 2 into 2 cos square x. Now here you see cos square x you will get in the numerator also. When you take 4 sin x common, you will get 1 minus sin square x, which is cos square x, and cos square x terms will be generated here also. So this gives you a hint that the real culprit is the cos square x, because of which you are getting 0 by 0 form. So somehow if you cancel out this cos square x, you can easily get the answer. So that's what we will try to do that. Now here, first of all, this in the denominator we have 2 sin 2x into sin 3x by 2, which I will write it as it is, because we have got another term, we have got 2 cos here, cos 5x by 2, cos 3x by 2. When you open the bracket, this becomes minus cos 3x by 2. And what is cos 5x by 2 minus cos 3x by 2? You will get cos c minus cos d formula, which is minus 2 times sin of c plus d by 2. That means 5x by 2 plus 3x by 2, which is 8x by 2, that is 4x divided by 2, which comes out to be sin of 2x into sin of c minus d by 2, which is 5x by 2 minus 3x by 2, which is 2x by 2 divided by x by 2. So this comes out to be sin of x by 2. So this is cos 5x by 2 minus cos 3x by 2. And what I said is, here if I am taking root 2 common with the minus sign, I get 1 plus cos 2x, which is 2 times cos square x. Now here these 2 sin 2x can be taken common. So what I get is, I will get limit x approaching to pi by 2. Here it is 4 root 2 multiplied by, if I take 4 sin x common, what I get is 1 minus sin square x, which is nothing but cos square x, I am directly writing it here, divided by, here when I take 2 sin 2x common here in these two expressions, so we get 2 sin 2x factor out, what you get is sin 3x by 2 minus sin x by 2, which can be simplified using sin c minus sin d formula, which is 2 times cos of c plus d by 2. That means 3x by 2 plus x by 2 divided by 2, so that comes out to be cos of x into sin of c minus d by 2, which is 3x by 2 minus x by 2 upon 2, so which comes out to be sin of x by 2. And here we get 2 root 2 cos square x. Now here you can see sin 2x, I can write it as 2 sin x into cos x, and 1 cos x is here. So you can clearly see that you can cancel the cos square x in both numerator and denominator. How? Because this sin 2x, if I write this sin 2x as 2 into sin x into cos x. So we have 1 cos x here, 1 cos x here. Cos square x is cancelled. This cos square x is also cancelled. And this cos square x is also cancelled. Now for x is equal to pi by 2, it is no more an indeterminate form. So you can easily solve it. So what you get when you put x is equal to pi by 2 now here, you will get 4 into 4, which is 16 times root 2 into sin pi by 2 is 1. I can directly substitute x equal to pi by 2 here. This is 2 into 2 is 4 into 2 is 8 multiplied by sin pi by 2 is 1. And sin, this is x by 2, that is sin pi by 4, which is actually 1 upon root 2 minus 2 root 2, because this cos square x was cancelled. Now 8 divided by 2 root 2, you will get 4 root 2. So 4 root 2 minus 2 root 2, the denominator becomes 2 root 2 and numerator is 16 root 2. So you will get 16 upon 2, which is 8. So 8 will be the value of this limit. So 8 is the answer to this question. The problem based on calculus which has been asked in JEE Advanced this year can be solved in hardly 4 to 5 steps. If you closely monitor the function given in the question. Here in this question we have been given a function f of x such that f0 is equal to 1 and f dash x is equal to fx upon b square plus x square. Now here he is asking which of these options are the correct option. It's a multiple correct choice type of a question in which more than one answer can be correct. The options which are given to us is whether f is an increasing function, decreasing function, fx into f of minus x equal to 1, f of x minus f of minus x is equal to 0. These are the four options and we have to check which of them are the correct answers. Now here what we have been given is f dash x is equal to fx upon b square plus x square. Now if you observe, if I take this fx down, the equation now becomes f dash x upon f of x is equal to 1 upon b square plus x square. Now here if I see the denominator is fx and numerator is the derivative of fx. This should clearly give you a hint that if I integrate both the sides, that means if I integrate left hand side and the right hand side, this integration is very simple. If I take fx as t, my f dash dx becomes equal to dt. So dt upon t, this is basically nothing but log t. That means the integration of the left hand side part will be log of f of x. As simple as that. What will be right hand side? It's a standard integral, 1 upon x square plus b square, which is 1 upon b into tan inverse of x upon b. And plus we have the constant of integration c, correct? Now what is given about the function is f0 is equal to 1, which can be used to find out the value of this constant of integration c. If I put x is equal to 0, my f of 0 is given to us as 1. So log of 1 will be 0 is equal to, when I put x is equal to 0, this tan inverse of 0 becomes equal to 0 into 1 by b is 0. So plus c, that means the constant of integration is equal to 0. So I can write c is equal to 0. So this is my required function. Now if I want to get fx out of it, this log will come onto the right hand side, becomes exponential function. So we get f of x is equal to this log becomes e to the power this whole value, which is 1 upon b tan inverse of x upon b. So this gives us the value of the function f of x. Now here if you see this power, whatever be the power, we know that exponential function is always positive. irrespective of whatever be the power, because all these values are real values, b and x, which has been given in the question that b is a non-zero real number. So if b is real, tan inverse of x upon b is also real. So for all the real values of x, my exponential value will always be a positive value. That means what I can comment on is my fx is always greater than 0 for all the real values of x and also for all the values of b. That means if I take again this equation, numerator we have fx which is always positive, we have seen, and denominator is as such positive because these are the square numbers and b is a non-zero real number, so b square is always positive. So denominator and numerator both are positive, which means the function f dash x is always positive. So what the question gives us the hint that our f dash x is always greater than 0 for all the real values of x, for all the real and also for all the real values of b. For all these values, this function is always positive, which is already known to us. That means what? If the derivative of a function is always positive, the function is always an increasing function. So that means irrespective of whether b is positive or b is negative, this function will always be an increasing function. So our first option will be the right answer, that if b is greater than 0, f is an increasing function. Actually, it does not depend upon b, whether it is given or not, this part is always correct. So our first option is the right answer. In the second option, he is saying that f is a decreasing function, which is absolutely wrong, because whether b is positive or b is negative, we know that by f dash x equal to 0, we know that this function, our f of x, is always increasing. For this function is always increasing, so option B is wrong. Next is, he is asking us about f of x into f of minus x. Now let us see what is f of minus x. If I put x is equal to minus x for this fx, what is the value of f of minus x I get? Here, if you see here, this is e to the power 1 upon b tan inverse of minus x upon b. Now minus x upon b means tan inverse of this, tan inverse of minus x is minus tan inverse x, because tan inverse is a odd function. So this minus sign will come over here. So we get f of x is equal to e to the power minus 1 upon b into tan inverse of x upon b. This is my f of minus x. Now in the option C, we have to get fx into f of minus x. So f of x into f of minus x now becomes this value multiplied by this value f of x. So it is e to the power 1 upon b tan inverse x by b into e to the power minus 1 upon b tan inverse x upon b. So the powers have to be added when the exponential functions are multiplied. So if I add on the power on this fx is 1 upon b, this is actually 1 upon b into tan inverse x by b, tan inverse x by b, and this is minus 1 upon b tan inverse of x by b. So obviously what will happen is this, both the values will cancel out each other, this and this value. So my this function f of x into f of minus x becomes equal to 1, because e to the power 0 is 1, which is given in this option C. So clearly option C is also the right answer. Coming to the fourth option, f of minus x is equal to 0. Now if you see here, this is my f of x is this value 1 upon b into tan inverse of x upon b. This is my fx, okay, and this is my f of minus x. When I say fx minus f of minus x is equal to 0, means fx should be equal to f of minus x, but here both are not equal, because here the power is minus 1 upon b, here power is 1 upon b. So obviously this option will not be the right answer. So finally what we get is option A and option C are the right answers to this question. we will now take a very good problem from Hyperbola, which has been asked in JEE Advanced 2020 Paper 2. The question says, let A and B be positive real numbers such that A is greater than 1 and B is less than A. Let P be a point in the first quadrant that lies on the hyperbola x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to 1. Suppose the tangent to the hyperbola at P passes through the point 1, 0, and suppose normal to the hyperbola at P cuts off equal intercept on the coordinate axis. Let delta denotes the area of the triangle formed by the tangent at P, normal at P and the x-axis. If E denotes the eccentricity of the hyperbola, then which of the following statements are true? That means we need to identify which of them are the correct options. This is a very standard problem of coordinate geometry. Generally, the problems which has been asked in coordinate geometry are more of procedural in nature. That means if you just follow the process what is given in the question, you will automatically get the answer. Like in this question, they have first given a hyperbola x square by a square minus y square by b square equal to 1, which is a very standard hyperbola. So if I draw this curve, say along the coordinate axis, okay, so the hyperbola would be something like this. After this, the question says that we are drawing the tangent to the hyperbola at a point P. So I will assume any point P on this hyperbola, and if I draw a tangent at this point, say this becomes the tangent to the hyperbola at the point P, which is intersecting this hyperbola at a point T. Now it is saying that it passes through the point 1, 0. That means the tangent is intersecting the x-axis at the point 1, 0. Next thing, he is talking about the normal, that the normal to the hyperbola at P. So I will draw the normal to the hyperbola at the point P. So it would be going something like this. I can extend it to the y-axis also. Now this normal can cut off the equal intercept at the coordinate axis. So normal here is a line which is making equal intercept to the coordinate axis. Now we know that any straight line, when it cuts off the equal intercept on the coordinate axis, the slope of that line becomes equal to minus of 1. Okay, this concept we need to understand before we solve this question. Now that means the slope of the normal, say Pn is the normal, then what is known to us is the slope of the line joining P to N. So this slope is equal to minus 1 because it is making equal intercept along the axis. Second important thing is, we also know that tangent and normal both are always perpendicular to each other. That means what would be the slope of the tangent PT? The slope of the tangent will be the negative reciprocal of the slope of the normal. So minus 1 upon minus 1, that is equal to 1. So the slope of the tangent. So this gives us the information about the slope of the tangent to the hyperbola. Okay. And then what it is saying is it is talking about the area of the triangle at the point P between the normal Pn, tangent Pt, and along the x-axis. That means they are asking us delta is the area of the triangle Ptn. And then they are asking us which is the correct answers. Now here, if I assume the parametric coordinate of the point P as, say, A sec theta, B tan theta, then what would be the equation of the tangent at the point P? That means what is the equation of the tangent PT? It is simply X times sec theta divided by A minus Y times tan theta divided by B is equal to 1. This is the equation of the tangent at the point P. Now this tangent is first of all passing through the point 1, 0 as given in the question. What I will put x is equal to 1, y equal to 0, because 1, 0 will satisfy the equation of the tangent. So putting x is equal to 1 and y equal to 0, what I get is 1 into sec theta divided by a is equal to 1. That means sec theta becomes equal to, this full thing becomes 0 because y equal to 0 and I put x is equal to 1. So sec theta becomes equal to a, 1 into a, that is equal to a. Sec theta becomes equal to a. Now this is the first information we got, that a is equal to sec theta. Now second important thing is this slope of the tangent. As we have seen, the slope of the tangent line PT is equal to 1, that means the slope of this line is equal to 1. Okay, now what is the slope of this tangent PT? I will take it as minus of sec theta upon a divided by the coefficient of y, which is minus of tan theta upon b. Minus of tan theta upon b, this is the slope of the line PT, which is here sec theta is equal to a. So if I write sec theta equal to a, these two quantities will be cancelled. Minus minus is also cancelled. This value is equal to 1 means your b becomes equal to tan theta. So another important result we got, sec theta is equal to a and tan theta is equal to b. Now this way we can write down the coordinate of the point P as in terms of trigonometric form. How will we write? Because this point is a sec theta, b tan theta. If I write a as sec theta and b as tan theta, the same coordinate can be written as sec theta into sec theta, which is sec square theta. And because b is tan theta into tan theta is tan square theta. So the coordinate of P can also be written as sec square theta comma tan square theta. This becomes the coordinates of the point P. So we got the point P. Now if we know this point, then what can we conclude from this particular information? They are saying, what would be the eccentricity? We can comment on the eccentricity of the hyperbola. The eccentricity of the hyperbola is given by the formula e square will be equal to 1 plus b square by a square. 1 plus b square by a square for the standard hyperbola. So we get 1 plus, what is b here? B is tan theta, so I will write it as tan square theta divided by a. What is a here? A is sec theta, so divided by sec square theta. Now here you see tan square theta is sin square theta upon cos square theta, and sec square theta is 1 upon cos square theta. So in numerator and denominator, the cos square theta will get cancelled out. You will get e square is equal to 1 plus sin square theta. Now in the option, he is asking us to comment on the value of e will lie in which interval. So we can here find out the value of e square is 1 plus sin square theta, and sin theta lies between 0 and 1. Sin square theta lies between 0 and 1. So our 1 plus sin square theta, 1 plus sin square theta would lie between 1 plus 0 and 1 plus 1. That means it will lie between 1 plus 0 is 1 plus 2, 1 plus 1, which is 2. So our e square lies in the interval from 1 to 2. That means we can say e will lie between 1 and root 2, because e square lies between, this is nothing but e square, this is actually nothing but the value of e square. So because e square lies between 1 and 2, e should lie between 1 and root 2. So we got the value of e between 1 and root 2, which is matching with our option A. So option A is the right answer to this question. So option A is right, so obviously option B is wrong. Now we need to find out the area of the triangle PTN. What would be the area? So for that, first we will find out the equation of the normal at the point P. Now we know the slope of the normal is equal to minus 1. We also know that the normal passes through the point P, whose coordinate we have written it as sec square theta comma tan square theta. So what would be the equation of the normal at the point P? That is, the equation of the line PN will be given by, you can use the point slope form, so which is y minus y1 is tan square theta is equal to slope of the normal, which is equal to minus 1 multiplied by x minus x1 is sec square theta. So if I take everything on one side, this minus of x comes on left becomes x, and this is plus y becomes equal to minus tan square theta comes on the right, we get tan square theta, and this is plus sec square theta. So the equation of the normal becomes x plus y equal to tan square theta plus sec square theta, which is the equation of the line PN. Now with this we can find out the coordinates of the point N, because this line intersects the x-axis where y equal to 0. If I put y equal to 0 in the equation of the line, we get the x-coordinate of the point N as sec square theta plus tan square theta. Now what we need is the area of the triangle PTN, which is half of base into height. So first we will find out the distance from T to N. So what is the distance from T to N? It will be this whole thing, means the difference in the x coordinate of N and the x coordinate of T. X coordinate of N is sec square theta minus tan square theta, and x coordinate of T is 1, and we know that this is sec square theta plus tan square theta minus 1. So sec square theta minus 1 is tan square theta, and tan square theta plus tan square theta will give you 2 tan square theta. So the distance from T to N is 2 tan square theta, and we know that tan theta is equal to b, so I can write it as 2b square. That means this distance tn becomes equal to 2b square. And what would be the height of this triangle? The altitude of this triangle will be the y coordinate of the point P, correct? And the y coordinate is tan square theta. So again we know that tan theta is equal to b, so y coordinate is tan square theta. That means the distance from, let us say this is the point M, then this distance from P to M is equal to b square. Now what would be the area of the triangle PTN? It is simply half of base into height. So I will write this area as delta S, half of the base, which is equal to 2b square here, and the altitude, which is b square. So this 2 and 2 gets cancelled out. We will get b square into b square, which is b raised to the power 4. So the area of the triangle is b to the power 4. So our option D is correct, option C is the wrong answer. So the final answer to this question is option A and option D. So A and D will be the right answers to this question. We are now taking a very challenging problem which has been asked in JEE Advanced 2020 paper 2. And in this question they have given us two functions f and g. About the function fx, they have given us that this f is satisfying this functional equation f of x plus y equal to fx plus fy plus f of x into f of y. And then they have given us a relation between fx and gx, that fx is equal to x times g of x. After that, they have given us another information about gx, that limit x approaching to 0, g of x is equal to 1. Now, based on this information, they are asking which of these options are correct. Now, in the first two options, they are asking us to find out the differentiability of f and g. And in the third and fourth option, they are asking us the value of f dash 0 and f dash 1 to verify whether both of them are equal to 1. Now, to start with, what I will do is I will first take the relation between f of x and g of x. They have given us that f of x is equal to x times g of x. The same information can be written as gx is equal to f of x divided by x. Now, about gx, what they have said is limit x approaching to 0, g of x is equal to 1. But what is gx here? Gx I have written it as f of x upon x. So I will write limit x approaching to 0 f of x divided by x. This value should also be equal to 1, because gx is nothing but f of x upon x we have written. Now if x is approaching to 0, I can actually derive two important things from here. The first conclusion what we can make is, when x is approaching to 0 means the denominator is 0. So in that case the numerator should also approach to 0, only then you can get a finite value of this limit. That means your f0 should necessarily be equal to 0 only. Only then this limit will exist. Otherwise, it will become something upon 0 will tend to infinity. So, limit will not exist. So, for existence of limit, your f0 should be equal to 0. First thing. Second important thing is, if I use the L'Hospital rule in this particular limit, what I get is limit x tending to 0, first derivative of numerator, which is f dash x, divided by derivative of denominator, because the function is tending to 0 by 0 form. So, I can use the LH rule over here. So, what I get is this value should also be equal to 1. If the value of this limit is 1, if I apply L'Hospital rule, then again this limit should also be equal to 1. That means if I am approaching to 0, my f dash x will be equal to 1. This gives me another important conclusion that f dash 0 is equal to f dash 0 is equal to 1. So, these are the two important information we get from here. Now, going ahead, I will now make use of this particular functional equation, which says that f of x plus y is equal to fx plus fy plus f of x into f of y. Now here, this equation will be holding for all real values of x. So, I can take y as some value, say h, where h is a very small number approaching to 0. So, if I write y is equal to h in this equation, what I get is f of x plus h, and this f of x I am taking on the left hand side. Why I am doing it is because this can be written in the form of the derivative of fx. So, to find out the value of f dash x, I am doing all this. So, my fx comes on the left hand side. Now, this becomes f of y, I can take common, then fx goes onto the left hand side. I can take f of y as common, and what is y? I have taken it as h. So, I have taken f of h common, this becomes 1 plus f of x. Now, what I do is, I will divide by h in both the side. Why? Because this will give me f dash x in the left hand side. We know that when limit h is approaching to 0, f of x plus h minus fx divided by h is nothing but f dash x. And here also I will take limit h tending to 0. I have divided h in both the sides. So, here also I will divide it by h. Now, if you pay attention here, 1 plus f of x is basically for h, it will be a constant, because 1 plus fx does not depend upon h, and the limiting variable in this question is h. So for h approaching to 0, this 1 plus fx will be treated as a constant. So, I will write it as 1 plus f of x outside, and I have the limit h approaching to 0 f of h divided by h, and the left hand side is nothing but f dash x. Now you can see we have already written limit x tending to 0 fx upon x is equal to 1. So what does this give us? From here this entire value becomes equal to 1. So if this value becomes equal to 1, what is my f dash x? From here, my f dash x becomes 1 plus f of x. Now, this is nothing but a differential equation. If I write f of x is equal to y, what is my f dash x? My f dash x becomes dy by dx. So, I can write this as dy by dx is equal to 1 plus y, taking y is equal to f of x. If I take y equal to f of x, this becomes a differential equation which can be variable separable form. I can divide 1 plus y in both the sides. So, I get dy upon 1 plus y becomes equal to dx. And then if I integrate both the sides, what I get is integral of dy upon 1 plus y is log of 1 plus y, and integral of dx is x, and plus I will put a constant of integration. Now to find out this constant of integration, we know that at x is equal to 0, value of y is equal to 0. This we have already got it. So I will write y equal to 0 and x equal to 0. Log 1 will become equal to 0 and the right hand side x becomes equal to 0. So this gives me the constant of integration c also equal to 0. So this gives us a relation that log of 1 plus y is equal to x. That means if log comes on this right hand side, this becomes e to the power x. So 1 plus y becomes equal to e to the power x. So this gives us y is equal to e to the power x minus 1. This is what we need, because once we get this y, which is nothing but f of x. So what we get is, we here got f of x, which is e to the power x minus 1. So if f of x is e to the power x minus 1, what is g of x? Because we know that gx is nothing but fx upon x. So this means our gx is equal to e to the power x minus 1 upon x. That means we got fx also, we got gx also. Now the question is solved, because now we can simply say, if this is fx e to the power x minus 1, then this fx is always continuous and differentiable for all real values of x, because e to the power x and 1 does not have problem anywhere as far as the continuity and differentiability is concerned. So our first option, which is f is differentiable for all real values of x, is correct. So our option A is the right answer. Second thing, he is saying if g of 0 equal to 1. Now here, if you see this e to the power x minus 1 upon x, this is not defined at x equal to 0. But in the question, they have said if x at x equal to 0, my gx is equal to 1. That means g of 0 is 1, and if I evaluate the limit of this gx at x is equal to 0, what I get is limit x tending to 0 e to the power x minus 1 upon x is also equal to 1. So the function becomes continuous at x equal to 0, because f0 is equal to 1. And also similarly, we can also prove that the function is differentiable also at x equal to 0. Now this function can have problem only at x equal to 0, otherwise this function is always continuous and differentiable. Now by taking g of 0 equal to 1, this problem is also solved. So our function gx now becomes continuous as well as differentiable at x is equal to 0. So our option B is also right. Option C is very simple. Once we got f of x, we can easily say what is the value of f dash x. The derivative of e to the power x minus 1, that is f dash x, becomes equal to e to the power x. Now if f dash x is equal to e to the power x, what is f dash 1? Put x is equal to 1. So this gives us that f dash 1 is basically equal to e. But here it is saying that f dash 1 is equal to 1. So this is not the right answer, because our f dash 1 comes out to be equal to e. Secondly, f dash 0 we have already got, otherwise also we can easily find out. Our f dash x is e to the power x, so our f dash 0 will be equal to 1. Okay, we also got it here, f dash 0 is equal to 1. So the derivative f dash 0 is equal to 1 is the right answer. So finally we get option A, option B and option D are the right answers to this question. We will take this problem from three-dimensional geometry, which has been asked in JEE Advanced 2020. The question says, let alpha, beta, gamma, delta be the real numbers such that alpha square plus beta square plus gamma square is not equal to 0 and alpha plus gamma is equal to 1. Suppose the point 3, 2, -1 is the mirror image of the point 1, 0, -1 with respect to the plane alpha x plus beta y plus gamma z is equal to delta, then which of the following statements are true? The options which are given to us are in terms of alpha, beta, gamma and delta, and this given equation of the plane is also expressed in terms of alpha, beta, gamma and delta. That means if we can find out the equation of this plane, automatically our four options can easily be verified. Now to get the equation of the plane, what information which has been given to us is, that this point 3 comma 2 comma minus 1 is the mirror image of the point 1 comma 0 comma minus 1. That means there is a point, say 1 comma 0 comma minus 1. Let us assume that this point is A. Now if I take this plane which is given to me like this, and the mirror image of this point about this plane, if I take, say, this is the point B which is having the coordinate as 3 comma 2 comma minus 1. Okay, the moment I say that the mirror image of, say, any point A is the point B, it gives us two information. The first thing is that this line AB is perpendicular to this plane, okay, because the mirror image of A about this plane B, about this plane is the point B. The second information which we can obtain is the midpoint of the line AB is the point which lie on the plane. Now for getting the equation of plane, we need the same information. What we need is the direction ratio of normal to the plane, that means the direction ratio of AB, and the coordinate of any point which lies on the plane, which in this case would be the midpoint of the line AB. So what we can say is that the direction ratio of the normal to this plane would be given by the direction ratio of the line AB, which is difference in the x coordinate, say 3 minus 1, which is equal to 2, difference in y coordinate, which is 2 minus 0, that is 2, and the difference in the z coordinate, which is minus 1 plus 1, which is 0. This would be the direction ratio of the normal to the plane. Secondly, we can find out the midpoint of the line segment AB, which would lie on the plane. So that will be given by 3 plus 1 upon 2, that is 2, 2 plus 0 upon 2, which is 1, and minus 1 minus 1 upon 2, which is minus of 1. And the equation of any plane which is having the direction ratio of the normal as ABC, and which is passing through the point x1 comma y1 comma z1, is given by A multiplied by x minus x1 plus B multiplied by y minus y1 plus C multiplied by z minus z1 is equal to 0. This would be the equation of such plane. Now here what we have is ABC. In place of that, I can substitute 2 comma 2 comma 0, and x1 comma z1 is this point which is passing through the plane. So here I can easily write the equation of the plane as 2 multiplied by x minus 2 plus 2 multiplied by y minus 1 plus 0 multiplied by z minus minus 1, that is z plus 1 equal to 0. Now what I can do is I can just simplify this equation. So I get x, I have cancelled 2 in both the sides, and then I have written x plus y, and coefficient of z is 0, and this is minus 2 minus 1 is minus 3, goes on to the right side, it will become plus 3. Okay, now here what we get is the equation of the plane. That is what we need here. This equation can be compared with this equation, and also what I can say is the coefficient of z in this equation is 0. Here the coefficient of z is gamma, so obviously our value of gamma is equal to 0. Secondly, alpha plus gamma equal to 1 is given to us. That means alpha plus 0 is equal to 1, that is alpha is equal to 1. So we got the value of alpha also. Now if I compare the two equations, alpha x plus beta y plus gamma z is equal to delta, and x plus y plus 0 into z is equal to 3, what I get is alpha divided by 1 is equal to beta divided by 1 is equal to gamma divided by 0 is equal to delta divided by 3. So what we get from here is alpha is equal to 1, we already got, so beta upon 1 is equal to 1. So this gives us beta is equal to 1, and gamma is equal to 0 we already got, and delta will be equal to 3. Delta equal to 3. So that is what we need. Now we just have to compare it with the given option. So alpha plus beta. So alpha plus beta here is alpha is 1 and beta is 1. So alpha plus beta is equal to 2, which is matching with the first option. Then delta minus gamma. Our delta is equal to 3 and gamma is equal to 0. So 3 minus 0 is equal to 3, which is again matching with the second option. So second option is also correct. Then delta minus beta. Here delta is equal to 3 and beta is equal to delta plus beta. So beta is equal to 1. So 3 plus 1 equal to 4. So which is matching with the third option. So third option is also correct. Lastly, alpha plus beta plus gamma, which is equal to 1 plus 1 plus 0, that is 2, which is not equal to delta because delta is equal to 3. So the last option is not correct. So finally, we have the option A, option B and option C are the correct answer. So this way we can easily solve this question. Let's take this problem from vectors. The question says, let A and B be positive numbers. Suppose vector PQ is equal to AI cap plus BJ cap and vector PS is equal to AI cap minus B times J cap. Are the adjacent sides of the parallelogram PQRS? Let vector U and vector V be the projection vectors of vector W equal to I cap plus J cap along vector PQ and vector PS respectively. If magnitude of vector U plus magnitude of vector V is equal to magnitude of vector W, and if area of the parallelogram PQRS is equal to 8, then which of the following statements are true? Now here in this question, what he says is he has given us a parallelogram PQRS. Okay, so I will first draw a parallelogram PQRS. So let us say this is PQRS. Vector PQ is given as AI cap plus B J cap, and vector PS they have given as AI cap minus BJ cap. So AI cap minus BJ cap. This is vector PS. Now after this it says that U and V, so they have given us two more vectors U and V. These are the projection vectors of vector W along vector PQ and vector PS respectively. That means what is vector U here? Vector U is the projection vector of vector W along vector PQ. So this is the projection of the vector W. Vector W is I cap plus J cap. Along which vector? Along the vector PQ. And what is vector PQ? Vector PQ is AI cap plus BJ cap. So I have written it as AI cap plus BJ cap. Now what is the value of the projection of a vector along the other vector? That means what will be the magnitude of the projection? What will be the magnitude of the projection vector U? It will be the dot product of I cap plus J cap and AI cap plus BJ cap, which is A plus B divided by the magnitude of AI cap plus BJ cap, because we are finding out the projection along this vector only. So whichever, along which direction we are taking the projection, we will take the magnitude of this vector, which is given by under root of A square plus B square. In the same way, we can find out the magnitude of the vector V. So what is magnitude of vector V? It is nothing but, they have given us, it is the projection of which vector? Projection of W, which is I cap plus J cap along which vector? Along the vector PS. And what is PS? AI cap minus BJ cap. So I have written it as AI cap minus BJ cap, which you can write it as the dot product of these two vectors, this vector and this vector, which is a minus b divided by magnitude of a I cap minus b j cap, which is under root of a square plus b square. This is the magnitude of vector v. So we got vector u, vector v magnitudes. After this, it says that magnitude of vector u plus magnitude of vector v is equal to magnitude of vector w. This result, now we can make use of. Now you can write magnitude of vector u plus magnitude of vector v is equal to magnitude of vector w. What does it mean? Magnitude of vector u is a plus b upon under root of a square plus b square, and magnitude of vector v is a minus b upon under root of a square plus b square, and this value is equal to magnitude of vector w, and vector w is I cap plus j cap, whose magnitude is equal to under root of 1 square plus 1 square, which is equal to root 2. Now it becomes very simple because the denominator is same, so I can write it as under root of a square plus b square, and I can simply add the numerator a plus b plus a minus b. This is equal to root 2. Now what I will do is take root of a square plus b square on this side, squaring both the sides, b and minus b is cancelled out, so 2a whole square will be equal to 4a square, and this is root 2 square, which is 2 multiplied by a square plus b square, so I can write it as 2a square plus 2b square. So this 2a square comes on the left hand side, so 4a square minus 2a square is 2a square, that means 2a square equal to 2b square, which means a square equal to b square, so this I will write it as a square is equal to b square. Now we know that a and b are the positive number, that means if a square is equal to b square and both a and b are positive, so I can write a is equal to b. This is one important result which we will use it. Now one more important thing what they have said is the area of the parallelogram PQRS is 8, that means this parallelogram is having the area equal to 8. So what will be the area of the parallelogram? It is the magnitude of the cross product of PQ and PS. So first we will find out the cross product of PQ and PS. So what is the value of PQ cross PS? It will be simply, we will use the determinant formula, which is I cap, J cap, K cap, coefficient of IJK in the vector PQ, which is A, B and 0, and coefficient of IJK in vector PS, which is A minus B and 0. So what we get is I cap multiplied by 0 minus J cap multiplied by 0 plus K cap multiplied by minus AB. Minus AB means minus 2AB. This is the value of PQ cross vector PQ cross vector PS, which is this value. Now what is the area of the parallelogram PQRS? The area of the parallelogram PQRS will be nothing but the magnitude of the cross product of PQ and PS. So this value magnitude will be simply 2AB. Okay, so it will be simply 2AB. Now this 2AB is actually equal to 8 as per the question, because the area is given to us as equal to 8. So this tells me that A into B is equal to 8. Now A is equal to B. Okay, and sorry, 2AB is equal to 8, that means A into B is equal to 4, and what is this given is A equal to B, so I can write A square is equal to 4, that means A is equal to 2, and if A is equal to 2, automatically B is also equal to 2, so A and B both are equal to 2. Now we can verify all the 4 options. First is, he is saying A plus B is equal to 4, which is correct because A and B both are equal to 2, so A plus B will be equal to 4. Second option he is saying, so first option is correct. Second option he is saying that A minus B is equal to 2, which is obviously wrong because A minus B will be 0 over here. So this is not the right answer. Now coming on to the third option, which says that the length of the diagonal PR. Now let me take the diagonal PR. So what will be the length of this diagonal? If you want to find out the length of this diagonal, then it will be nothing but the sum of vector PQ and vector PS. If I add both the vector, I will get the length of the diagonal PR, which is given by 2a i cap. Okay, and another diagonal will be having the length 2b j cap. If I subtract them, I will get 2b j cap. So what we get is the length of the diagonal PR is equal to 2 into a. What is a here? A is equal to 2. So it will be 2 into I cap, which is equal to 4 I cap. So length of the diagonal PR will be equal to 4 I cap magnitude, which is equal to 4. And the length is given to us as 4 only. So option C is the right answer, because the length of the diagonal is coming out to be 4 only. Lastly, he is saying that vector W is the angle bisector of the vectors PQ and PS. Okay. Now here, what is the vector PQ? If you see, vector PQ is, what is vector PQ? We have vector PQ is equal to 2 I cap plus 2 j cap, because A equal to B equal to 2. So vector PQ will be equal to 2 times I cap plus j cap. Okay. This is our vector PQ. And what is vector W? Vector W is I cap plus j cap. Now this and this, both of them are in the same direction. Now how can it is possible that vector PQ is in the same direction of vector W? If both of them are in the same direction, then how can it be an angle bisector? An angle bisector cannot be parallel to the two vector, any of the two vectors. So it is actually not possible only. So this option will definitely be the wrong answer. We have the right answer only as the option A and option C. Those will be the only correct options for this question. We will now take a real challenging problem, which is based on binomial coefficients. Now here they have given us three expressions like this. The first one on the right hand side, they have written factorial s upon factorial r into factorial s minus r. Now just by looking at it, you should be able to make out it is something of the form ncr, which we write it as factorial n upon factorial r into factorial n minus r. We are already familiar with that. So this is nothing but scr. Now for this to be defined, the value of r must be less than s or equal to s. So if r is greater than s, this will not be defined. So what they have written is, if r is greater than s, we just have to write it this whole thing equal to 0. Okay, so this is nothing but scr. We need not to worry about it. Now coming on to this one, they have written as gmn, which is another function of two positive integer. They have written m and n are the positive integer. So this is the function of m and n, and that is equated as the summation from p going from 0 to m plus n. In the numerator, they have written f of m n p. Now this f of m n p is another function, okay, which they have defined it over here. F of m n p upon n plus p c p. Okay. Now again, they have said f of m n p is summation I is going from 0 to p. This is mci, n plus I cp, m plus n c p plus p minus I. Now I will work on this. I will start from here. So what we can do is, we can write this as summation I going from 0 to p. This is mci, which I will write it as it is mci. Okay. Now here it is nci cp. So nci cp can be written as factorial n plus I divided by factorial p into factorial n plus I minus p. Correct. The last one is p plus n cp minus I, which I will write it as factorial p plus n upon, this is p minus I factorial. After this, it is p plus n minus p plus I. So p and minus p will get cancelled out. We will get only factorial n plus I, factorial n plus I. Now if you observe here, this n plus I will get cancelled. This will get cancelled. Now what we are left out with is factorial p plus n, factorial p here. Now factorial p plus n upon factorial p, again by looking at it, you should see that it is something of p plus n cp. Only thing which is missing here is factorial n. So what I will do is I will multiply and divide by factorial n, and I can do that because here the summation variable is I. That means what is variable is I. N is a constant. So I will multiply and divide by n. Now what will happen as a result of which this factorial p plus n upon factorial p into factorial n, this becomes p plus n cp. So what I will do is I will write it over here, summation I is going from 0 to p mci. I will just write it as it is, and this p plus n factorial upon p factorial into n factorial, I am writing it as p plus n cp. Okay, this is p plus n cp, and then what is left out with me is this is factorial n upon factorial n plus I minus p and factorial p minus I. Now if I add n plus I minus p minus I, then minus I is cancelled with plus I, minus p is cancelled with plus p. This will be, if I add them, add these values, n plus I plus p minus I will get n only. So and numerator also we have factorial n. So this can be written as n p n c p minus I. N c p minus I, correct? If you solve n c p minus I, you will get these three values only. Now this is what we get in the next step. Now here if you see this p plus n c p, it does not contain I, because our I is the variable only. So p and n are constants, so that also I will take it outside the summation variable. So I will take it as p plus n cp. Then we have sigma mci into n c p minus I, where I is going from 0 to p. Now if you look here, this m and n both are constant, and if you add I and p minus I, this lower values, they are also, some of them will be a constant. I plus p minus I will be p only. Now here we will make use of a very important property of binomial coefficient, that if this happens, that this lower subscript, this I and p minus I, if their sum is a constant, then, and if this is kept in the whole summation thing, now this entire thing, I am saying this entire sigma expression, this can simply be replaced by, this will simply be replaced by m plus n. So I will add these two values, and then this is I plus p minus I. So I and minus I gets cancelled out, I will get cp. Okay, and one more thing which is written over here is p plus n cp. Now what is this we have? This is nothing but f of m and p, because I was working on this only. So this is nothing but f of m n p, correct? Now coming on to this f and p can be used over here. Now my g of mn, this function is defined by sigma p going from 0 to m plus n. Here p is going from 0 to m plus n. Now this is f of mn p, which I can simply write it from here. This is nothing but p plus n cp multiplied by m plus n cp. And in the denominator what we have is n plus p cp. So I will write n plus p cp. Now if you see here, numerator and denominator both have n plus p cp. This is also m plus n p plus n cp, this is also p plus n cp. So this both the values will get cancelled out. So what we are asked in all the four options are in terms of GMN. So finally we got GMN. This can be written as what we will write here in GMN. This is sigma p going from 0 to m plus n, and this is only we have m plus n cp. Okay, now if you solve it, if you start p is equal to 0, okay, p equal to 0, then it becomes m plus n c0. Then you put p is equal to 1, then it becomes m plus n c1. Like that it keeps going on. So it keeps on till m plus n. So last value becomes m plus n c m plus n. So this one, if you expand the sigma, it is like m plus n c0 plus m plus n c1 plus m plus n c2 goes on till m plus n c m plus n, which can be written as 2 raised to the power m plus n. So this entire thing, this entire g of mn can simply be written as 2 to the power m plus n. That's it. So we got this value g of mn. Now let us look at the options. Now the question is done. If you see the option A, on the left hand side we have gmn, which is 2 to the power m plus n. On the right hand side we have written gnm, that means m and n both are interchanged. So interchanging m and n doesn't make any difference here, because this 2 to the power m plus n is symmetrical with respect to m and n. So if I write m in place of n and n in place of m, it is still 2 to the power m plus n. So ultimately it is the same value. So our option A will be the right answer. Okay, so option A is correct. Coming on to the second option, what they have written is gm n plus 1. Okay, now here if you see gmn, here n is replaced by n plus 1. So instead of n, if I write n plus 1, what is this value becomes? My this expression becomes 2 raised to the power m plus, instead of n I will write n plus 1. So this is 2 to the power m plus n plus 1. What is the right hand side? Right hand side is m plus 1 n. Okay, so that doesn't make any difference, because as I said, this expression is symmetrical with respect to m and n. So writing instead of n plus 1, now I have written here m plus 1. So this becomes 2 to the power m plus 1 plus n, which are same values. Actually, whether I write 2 to the power m plus n plus 1 or 2 to the power m plus 1 plus n, it is ultimately the same thing. So option B is also correct. Now third option is g2m 2n. Okay, g2m 2n means if I write it as 2m 2n, so instead of m it becomes 2m, instead of n it becomes 2n. So 2m plus 2n, so this is g2m 2n. On the right hand side they have written this should be equal to 2 times g of mn. G of mn is 2 to the power m plus n, but you see these two are not equal. Okay, so option C is actually not correct. Coming to the last option, wherein he says g of 2m 2n, which is the same thing, 2 to the power 2m plus 2n, and that should be equal to, on the right hand side, g of mn. G of mn is 2 to the power m plus n, and g of mn square means 2 to the power m plus n square. This, if you simplify, is it nothing but 2 to the power 2m plus 2n, which is matching with our left hand side. So our option D is correct. So finally what we get is, we have option A, option B and option D. These are the correct answers to this question. Okay, so let's take this problem based on permutation and combination. What the question says is, an engineer is required to visit a factory for exactly 4 days during the first 15 days of every month, and it is mandatory that no two visit take place on the consecutive days. Then the number of all possible ways in which such visits can be made by the engineer during 1st to 15th of June 2021 is. Question is quite simple. What he is saying is, the engineer is supposed to make 4 visits in the 15 days. The only condition what the question has imposed to us is, no to visit should occur on the consecutive days. What exactly it means is, suppose if today he has made the visit, the engineer cannot make the visit on tomorrow. That's the only restriction which we have. Now, to understand this problem, let us first see, suppose if he is making a visit on a certain day, then I am placing a tick for that. And suppose if the engineer is not making any visit on a particular day, then I am putting a cross for that. So total we have how many days? 15 days. So in 15 days, if he is making 4 visit, then I will place 4 ticks like this, 1, 2, 3 and 4. And suppose remaining 11 days he is not making any visit, then I am making 11 cross. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 and 11. Effectively, the question comes of the form that how many ways I can arrange these ticks and cross such that no two ticks are consecutive. Because if any two ticks are coming consecutive, this would imply that the engineer has visited on two consecutive days, which is not allowed as per the question. So what I need to do is, I need to ensure that to make the arrangement of these ticks and crosses in such a way that no two ticks are consecutive. That's the only thing which I will have to do. Now the easiest way to approach this question is, I will use the gap method. Now what we do in the gap method is, I will make first 11 cross, because there is no restriction on cross. The only restriction is on the tick, that the two ticks are not consecutive. So where there is no restriction, I will place 11 cross. So I am placing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 and 11. So I have placed 11 cross like this. Now I have to put the ticks in such a way that no two ticks should be consecutive. That means, what are my allowed position of keeping a tick? I can put a tick over here, here, here. So like that, how many places do I get to put a tick? That means I can place a tick here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12. These are the 12 places I can place a tick. Now, if I am doing it like this, I can choose any of the four ways. Like, suppose if I am placing a tick over here, here, here and here. Now you can see that irrespective of the position, where four position I am putting a tick, between any two ticks you will have minimum one cross. That means no two ticks are consecutive. So my requirement is met. Now here, how many ways can I place 11 crosses? Because all the crosses are exactly same, that would imply that the engineer has not made any visit. So there is no distinction between any two crosses. So there is only one way to arrange these 11 crosses. So crosses can be arranged only in one ways. Then the next thing is, I have to select the tick. Where should I place the tick? So that I have already decided that I have to place the tick in, out of these 12 positions, I have to select 4 positions. Okay, out of the 12 positions which I have marked it like this, I have to select any 4 positions. That can be done in 12C4 ways. So in 12C4 ways, I will do the selection of tick. Now these ticks can be arranged only in one way. Again, for the same reason, once I put a tick, that would mean that the engineer has made the visit on that particular day. So there is no distinction between any two ticks. So there is only one way to arrange the ticks. So finally, the number of ways the engineer can make the visit comes out to be 12C4 ways, which can easily be calculated as factorial 12 divided by factorial 4 into factorial 8, or I can write the same thing as 12 into 11 into 10 into 9 divided by 1 into 2 into 3 into 4. Okay, so here you can have 3 into 4 will give you 12. Okay, and 2 into 5 is equal to 10. So finally I get 55 into 9. So 55 multiplied by 9, that will give me 5 here, and 45 plus 4 is 49. So the total number of ways by which the engineer can make a visit is 495. So the answer to this question is 495. That would be the answer. Let's take another problem on permutation and combination, which is again a very easy and a very straightforward question. As I keep saying always that no, the problem which are coming in JEE Advanced are not necessarily very tough or very lengthy. Sometimes the question are so simple and straightforward that you can do it in less than 1 minute, and this is one such very easy question. Let's see what the question says. In a hotel, 4 rooms are available, 6 persons are to be accommodated in these 4 rooms in such a way that these rooms contain at least 1 person and at most 2 persons. Then the number of possible ways in which this can be done is, means what he is saying in this question is, totally we have got 4 rooms with us and we need to accommodate 6 persons in these 4 rooms. The condition what we have is, in any room there cannot be more than 2 persons, and there should not be any room in which there is no person. Okay, these are the only 2 conditions we have. The easiest way to crack this question is by using the division and distribution. Okay, so what we will do is, we will do grouping of these 6 persons. How many ways can we group? Totally how many persons are there? 6 persons. So we need to group these 6 persons. Now what are the various ways to group these 6 persons with the given restriction? We can put 1 person in 1 room, 2nd person in another room, so there 1 person will go in that room. Now if I take the 3rd room also, if I take 1 person, then in the 4th room I have to accommodate how many persons? 3 persons, because the total number of persons are 6. But this is not allowed, because at most we can keep how many persons? At most we can keep only 2 persons. So if the 3 comes here, then this will not be allowed situation. So here also by force I have to keep him 2 persons and 2 persons here. Is there any other way to group these 6 persons? We will not find any other way to group these 6 persons. So the only possible way of doing the grouping is like this only. Now what we will do is, we will first divide these 6 persons into these 4 groups. So I will find out how many ways I can divide this 6 persons into the 4 groups like this. So that, how will I write? I will say factorial 6, because there are total 6 persons. Okay, now the first group contains 1 person, so factorial 1. Second group contains 1 person, so factorial 1 into factorial 1, that is factorial 1 square. Third group contains 2 persons, so it is factorial 2. And the fourth group also contains 2 persons, so factorial 2 once again. Now here this factorial 1 is repeated 2 times, for which I have to write factorial 2 here. And this factorial 2 is also repeating 2 times, so I will write factorial 2 here. So what is this? This is basically the number of ways to divide the 6 person into these 4 groups. Okay, this is the number of ways in which I can divide these 6 person into these 4 groups. Now what I need to do is, I need to distribute also into the 4 rooms. Okay, so you can consider it like this. These 4 groups are just like the packets. Okay, and what I am doing is, I am just distributing these 4 packets into the 4 rooms. 4 distinct packets which are to be distributed in 4 rooms. How many ways I can do it? This can simply be done in factorial 4 ways. So I will put factorial 4 over here. So this would be our answer. We will just simplify this. Now factorial 6 is equal to 720 divided by, this is factorial 1 square is 1, factorial 2 square is 4, multiplied by 2 into 2, and this is factorial 4, which is equal to 4 into 3 into 2 into 1, which is 24. Okay, now what we will do is, 4 into 2 is 8, 8 into 2 is 16. This 16 is cancelled with this 720, So 16 into 4 is 64 and 16 into 5 is 80. So it is 45 multiplied by 24. 24 into 5 is 120 and 96 plus 12 is 108. So what we get is 1080. So what he is asking is the number of possible ways it can be done. The answer should be equal to 1080. So quickly we can do this question. Let's take this problem based on probability, and what the question says is two fair dice with the faces numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6 are rolled together and the sum of the numbers on the faces is observed. This process is repeated till the sum is either a prime number or a perfect square. Suppose the sum turns out to be a perfect square before it turns out to be a prime number. If P is the probability that this perfect square is an odd number, then the value of 14 times P is. This question is basically related to the random experiment. We have taken a pair of dice. We keep rolling it till the time the sum which is appearing on the dice is either a prime number or a perfect square. This means we will stop the moment we get a prime number or a perfect square. Now what he is saying is the number comes out to be a perfect square, suppose, and then we need to find out the probability that this perfect square is basically an odd number. This is what we need to find out. Now if you see the solution in various sources, they will give you very complicated method where, you know, they will tell you creating several events and then making certain cases with the help of which they will make some infinite GP, and that's how we will get the answer. So this seems to be a very lengthy and very time consuming method. Now I am going to tell you a solution which is so simple that you can understand and solve it in less than 2 minutes. Now what I would say is, here what is being done in the experiment, we are repeating the process till the time the sum is a prime number or a perfect square, and then the question itself is saying that the sum is a perfect square before it becomes a prime number. That means the role of prime number is now over. Now what is important for us is the sum which is obtained is a perfect square. This is the only meaningful information till now. Okay, so I will take, say, an event A which is sum is a perfect, sum is a perfect square. Okay, the sum is a perfect square. I will take another event B in which I will say that the sum is an odd number. Now, how many ways can I get a perfect square? The outcome when the pair of dice is rolled is anywhere between 2 and 13. It can be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and goes on till 12. From 2 to 12, we will get the outcome. Now, between 2 to 12, which are the numbers which are the perfect square? It is only 4 and 9. These are the only two perfect square. Now, how will you get the outcome equal to 4? There are two ways. Either you will get the outcome equal to 4 or you will get the outcome as the 9. Now, 4 can be obtained from 1, 3, 2, 2 and 3, 1. These are the only ways by which you will get the outcome as 4. How many ways you will get 9? You can get it from 3, 6, 4, 5, 5, 4 and 6, 3. These are the ways you can get 9. Now here he is saying that the number is an odd number and also the perfect square. So this is basically a question of conditional probability, wherein the sum we have to get it as the odd number when it is also a perfect square. So I can say we need to find out the value of P of the number should be an odd number and it is given that it is a perfect square. So this is purely a case of conditional probability, wherein we have to find out the probability that the sum is an odd number when it is given to you that it is a perfect square. Only these two cases I need to consider. So here what I will say, it is equal to P of B intersection A divided by P of A. Now what is P of B intersection A? Means I have to take only those things which are the odd number also, which are the perfect square also. So this we get it only from these four cases. Okay, so that will be equal to 4 divided by, 4 is the number of favorable cases, divided by the total number of cases in the sample space is 36, because there are 36 possible combination when I roll a pair of dice. Similarly, what would be the probability that sum is perfect square? Then I can have all these cases 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So there are 7 cases in which the sum is a perfect square. So our required probability is 7 divided by, again the total number of cases in the sample space is 36. So the denominator will be 7 by 36. Now the required probability can be 4 divided by 7. So 4 by 7 is nothing but the value of P which is asked in the question, and they are saying what is the value of 14 times P. So 14 times P is simply 14 multiplied by, it is 14 multiplied by 4 by 7, which is equal to 8. So the final answer to our question will be equal to 8. So 8 will be the right answer. We are now taking the easiest problem of JEE Advanced 2020, which requires very minimum calculation, very standard question based on function. What the question says is, let the function f whose domain is from 0 to 1 and codomain is the real set, and this function is defined by f of x is equal to 4 to the power x upon 4 to the power x plus 2. Now then they are asking us to find out the value of f of 1 by 40 plus f of 2 by 40 plus f of 3 by 40 goes on till f of 39 by 40 minus f of 1 by 2. Now here only a small observation you need to do to solve this question. If you look at fx and if I see f of 1 minus x, what is f of 1 minus x? It is 4 raised to the power 1 minus x divided by 4 to the power 1 minus x plus 2. So if I multiply by 4 to the power x in numerator and denominator, I will get 4 divided by 4 plus 2 into 4 to the power x, and if I cancel 2 in both numerator and denominator, I get 2 divided by 2 plus 4 to the power x. Now here if you just observe, what is f of x plus f of 1 minus x? What is this value? Simply add this value and this value. This is 4 to the power x upon 4 to the power x plus 2. This is our f of x, and 2 upon 4 to the power x plus 2 is our f of 1 minus x. So what we get is 4 to the power x plus 2 divided by 4 to the power x plus 2. So this both numerator and denominator is getting cancelled out. So we get f of x plus f of 1 minus x is equal to 1. Now why I have thought it like this? My line of thinking was, we have f of 1 by 40 and f of 39 by 40. So 39 plus 1 is 40. Similarly, we have f of 2 by 40, and prior to that we have f of 38 by 40 whose sum is equal to 1, and this goes on like this. So what I am trying to tell you is, we have in the question given as f of 1 by 40 plus f of 2 by 40 plus f of 3 by 40. This goes on till say f of 18 by 40 plus f of 19 by 40, and then we have f of 20 by 40 After that, we get f of 21 by 40, which I am writing it over here. F of 21 by 40, then f of 22 by 40. This goes on like f of 37 by 40, f of 38 by 40, and f of 39 by 40. So why I have arranged it like this is 1 by 40 plus 39 by 40. This will become 40 by 40. So if this is x, then this becomes 1 minus x. So obviously these two values together become equal to 1. Similarly, f of 2 by 40 and f of 38 by 40 together become equal to 1. F of 3 by 40 and f of 37 by 40, they both will become equal to 1. Now this thing will keep happening like this. So this value is also equal to 1. This is also equal to 1. So all these values will be equal to 1. And after that, we have something minus f of 1 by 2 also. Now here, if you see, f of 20 by 40 is nothing but f of 1 by 2. So this f of 1 by 2 and this minus f of 1 by 2 will cancel each other. Now these two values, if you add on here, the sum of these two values is 1. This sum is also 1. This sum is also 1. And this 1 plus 1 plus 1, I am going till how many times? 1 by 40, 2 by 40, 3 by 40, and the last value is 19 by 40. So this comes out till 19 times. And this is 0 only. So 1 plus 1 plus 1 till 19 times. What is the value? This is nothing but equal to 19. So what we need to find out is the value of this whole thing, which is coming out to be 19. So 19 will be the answer to this question. So as I keep saying that JEE Advanced contains some very easy questions also, if you carefully scan and look at the paper. So these are the some of the first questions which you can do, so that your confidence will be built up, and then you can take on the entire paper very easily. Hope you have understood this question. Okay, so let's take this problem from integration, which is another easy question asked in JEE Advanced this year. The question mentions a function small f whose value at x is equal to pi is equal to minus of 6. After that, they have given us another function capital Fx, which is defined by the integration of the function small f. Okay, now from here, what we can say is, if capital Fx is the integration of small f, then I can say that the derivative of f will be equal to small f, because integration, differentiation, inverse of each other. So what I can do is, if I differentiate both the sides here, I will get, first I will differentiate capital F, which is given by capital F dash x, becomes equal to derivative of this integral, becomes equal to small fx. Okay, after this, the question says that integral from 0 to pi small f dash x plus capital Fx multiplied by cos of x is equal to 2, and then the question is asking about the value of small f at x equal to 0. Now to start with, we have this function f dash x plus capital Fx and another function cos of x, which are multiplied together. So whenever we have the product of the two functions, okay, when the two functions are multiplied and we have to find out the integration of this, what we generally do is we use the integration by parts. So here also we will do the same thing. So before that, we will first separate this f dash x and capital Fx. So what we get is integral from 0 to pi, this f dash x I am multiplying by cos of x, so this becomes small f dash x into cos of x, and then capital Fx we will multiply it by cos of x. So integration of capital Fx multiplied by cos of x with respect to x from 0 to pi limits. Okay, now this here in the first integral, if I use the integration by parts, what we do generally is we take the function whose integration is easy, or the function whose integration we can find out, we take it as the second function, and the function whose derivative can be easily obtainable can be taken as the first function. Now here you see f dash x, if you integrate the derivative of a function, you get the same function. So this function I will take it as the second function, because its integration is nothing but f of x, and this cos of x I can take it as the first function. So using integration by parts, first we will integrate the f dash x with respect to x multiplied by the first function, which is cos of x written outside the integral, minus what we take is the integration from 0 to pi, the integral of f dash x which we know is equal to fx multiplied by derivative of cos of x which is minus of sin x. So there is one minus already here, so minus minus becomes plus sin of x. Okay, this integration. So I have completed this part. Now coming on to this integral, capital fx into cos of x integration. Here we know that the derivative of capital fx, we just got it that capital fx derivative is small fx. So this we will be taking as the first function, because its derivative can be easily obtainable, and this cos of x I will take it as the second function. So here you see, earlier I have taken cos of x as the first function, here I am taking cos of x as the second function. This is the small thing which we should understand. Now here what we do is, these two functions are multiplied and we have to find out its integration. So what we can do is, we will first integrate the second function, which is cos of x multiplied by the first function capital fx written as it is, minus what we do is, we do integration of cos of x, which is sin of x here, into derivative of capital fx, which I am just writing as f dash x, and in the next step I can write this capital f dash x is small fx. Okay, this whole thing is given to us as equal to 2. Okay, this value we had already been given in the question, equal to 2. Now here you see the derivative of f dash x is nothing but f of x, so this becomes cos of x into f of x plus this integral from 0 to pi f of x sin of x dx. I am writing it as it is. Cos of x integral we know is equal to sin of x, so this becomes f of x multiplied by sin of x, and this is f dash x, which I am writing it as small fx, so this is minus of, and the limit is from 0 to pi here, so 0 to pi, this is sin of x into capital f dash integral is small fx is equal to 2. Now if you carefully see what is happening is, this value fx dx, fx sin x dx, and this is also fx sin x dx, limit from 0 to pi, limit from 0 to pi, both are having opposite sign, though can be cancelled each other. Okay, now here what I will do is, I will take the limit from 0 to pi, because now integration part is done. Okay, now we have to simply do the substitution of limit from 0 to pi over here and 0 to pi over here. So you can see that here it is cos of pi multiplied by f pi minus cos of 0 multiplied by f of 0, and here you see whatever is the value of capital F, if you put x is equal to pi, sin pi is 0 multiplied by this capital F will become 0, similarly sin 0 is also 0, so this function does not have any relevance, this is simply equal to 0, and on the right hand side it is equal to 2. Okay, so here if you see, cos of pi is minus 1 multiplied by f of pi, which is given in the question as minus of 6, minus cos 0 is equal to 1 multiplied by f of 0, which we have to find out, so I am writing it as f0 only, this is equal to 2. So they, now the question is solved. F0 comes on the right hand side, becomes minus F0 becomes plus F0, and this is equal to minus 1 into minus 6 is plus 6, and this plus 2 comes on the left. So 6 minus 2 becomes equal to 4. So finally what we get is the value of F of 0 is equal to 4. So 4 is the right answer to this question. Let me take the last problem of JEE Advanced 2020, and you can judge yourself whether the problems of JEE Advanced are really very tough. Now in this question, it defines a function f whose domain is from 0 to pi in terms of theta as f of theta is equal to sine theta plus cos theta whole square plus sine theta minus cos theta whole raised to the power 4. After that, he is saying that this same function f has a local minimum at certain values of theta, which is given by this set theta belonging to lambda 1 pi, lambda 2 pi, and goes on till lambda r pi. That means here he is asking us to find out all those values of theta where theta takes the local minimum value in the interval from 0 to pi. So we will get certain values of theta. Those values of theta we will compare with the elements of this set lambda 1 pi, lambda 2 pi, and so on. That means we will get the values of all the lambdas, and after that he is asking us what would be the addition of all these lambdas, that means lambda 1 plus lambda 2 and so on, what would be the addition of all those values. That is what he is asking in this question. Now to do that, I will start from what is given to me, the function f of theta. So if I write f of theta as, let me first simplify both these brackets. I have been given sine theta plus cos theta whole square, which I will write it as sine square theta plus cos square theta plus 2 times sine theta into cos of theta, and then I have sine theta minus cos theta whole raised to the power 4, which is nothing but sine theta minus cos theta whole square to the power 2. So sine theta minus cos theta whole square, I can write it as sine square theta plus cos square theta minus 2 times sine theta into cos theta whole square. Now here you, sine square theta plus cos square theta is 1, we know that, and 2 sine theta cos theta is sine 2 theta. So this value becomes sine square theta plus cos square theta, this entire thing becomes equal to 1, and 2 sine theta cos theta, I will write it as sine of 2 theta, correct? And then we have sine square theta plus cos square theta, which is again equal to 1. So this becomes 1 minus 2 sine theta cos theta whole square, and 2 sine theta cos theta can again, I will write it as sine 2 theta. So it is effectively 1 minus sine of 2 theta whole square. Again I will apply a minus b whole square formula, as simple as that. So this gives me 1 plus sine of 2 theta plus 1 plus, this becomes sine square 2 theta minus 2 times sine 2 theta. Now you can see that this equation, this expression becomes quadratic in terms of sine 2 theta. So I will write it as sine 2 theta square. From here, this is minus 2 sine theta plus sine 2 theta will give me minus of sine 2 theta, and 1 plus 1 becomes equal to 2. Now the easiest way to solve it basically is, I will just take the squaring method which you have already learned in class 10th, and what I do is I will just take convert it into a minus b whole square form. So this will be written as sine 2 theta whole square. So this is working like a square. Then I need 2ab, so 2 into, now this a I can write it as a square is sine 2 theta, so a becomes equal to sine 2 theta, and what I should multiply over here to cancel this 2, I will need 1 by 2 here. So 1 by 2 will be acting as b. So I will, in order to make it a minus b whole square, I got a square, I got minus 2ab, so I will need b square. So I will write 1 by 2 whole square, same number, I will subtract it so that the value of the expression would remain the same, and then what I will do is, this value is this whole thing, sine square 2 theta minus 2 times sine 2 theta into 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 sine plus 1 by 2 square will be equal to sine 2 theta minus 1 by 2 whole square. And this is 1 by 4 minus 1 by 4 plus 2, that means minus 1 by 4 plus 8 by 4, which is 7 by 4. So this is plus 7 by 4. Now what actually I need to find out the points of the local minimum, okay, for those values of theta, and then comparing it with the values given in this set. So when this will happen is when sine 2 theta is equal to 1 by 2. This will happen when this function will take local minimum, that means the minimum value of f of theta will occur when this sine 2 theta becomes equal to 1 by 2. Why? Because this is whole square form. Okay, now this whole square thing can never be negative, it will always be a non-negative number plus some constant 7 by 4. So to minimize this expression, because we have to get the local minimum, to minimize this expression, what we need is this whole square thing should be equal to 0. Now if this whole square thing has to become 0, then sine 2 theta will be equal to 1 by 2. So I will write sine of 2 theta should be equal to 1 by 2. Now if you see, theta is going from 0 to pi because the domain of the function is 0 to pi. Okay, so I would say if theta is going from 0 to pi, 2 theta will go from 0 to 2 pi. That means in the interval from 0 to 2 pi, I need to identify those values of theta for which sine 2 theta is equal to 1 by 2. So sine 2 theta equal to 1 by 2 means 2 theta can be equal to how much? 2 theta can be equal to pi by 6. 2 theta can also be equal to 5 pi by 6, because 5 pi by 6 also, again you are in the second quadrant, and sine of pi minus pi by 6 will be nothing but sine pi by 6 equal to 1 by 2. So for these two values, after that I, from 0 to pi, I will come to the third quadrant and fourth quadrant, where the value of sine is negative. So it cannot give us negative result, like it will not give us plus 1 by 2, it will always give you the negative result only. So here 2 theta can take only two values, that is pi by 6 and 5 pi by 6. What does it mean? What all values theta can take? From here, your theta can take only two values. One is pi by 12 and another is 5 pi by 12. These are the only two values of theta I will get. So here, if I am comparing with these values, so I am supposed to get r values of lambda. And here I got two values of lambda, that means lambda r is equal to 2. And what are the two values of lambda? Lambda 1 pi, r, two values of lambda will be comparing with lambda 1 pi. I will get lambda 1 pi is equal to pi by 12. So the value of my lambda 1 will be equal to 1 by 12. What will be the value of lambda 2? Means I will compare it with lambda 2 pi. So lambda 2 pi is 5 pi by 12. So obviously lambda 2 will be equal to 5 by 12. So I got the two values of lambda which is required for me, because he is asking us to find out the sum of all those values of lambda. So sum of those values of lambda will be 1 by 12. This should be 1 by 12 because I got pi by 12. So pi by 12, removing pi from here, I will get 1 by 12 and 5 by 12. These are the two values of lambda which I got. So adding those values, I will get 1 by 12 plus 5 by 12, which is equal to 6 by 12. 6 by 12 is nothing but 1 by 2. So the values of all, the sum of all these numbers will be 1 by 2, which is equal to 0.5. So the right answer for this question is 0.5. So you can see how easy that particular question is when you actually come on solving it. So don't be worried, don't be very feared when it comes to the JEE advanced exam. Some questions are really very easy. You just need to identify the right questions which are really made for you. Once you do that, you can do very good score. And once you do easy questions, automatically your mind will start activating, and you will be starting to doing more tough questions also, because then you will have get enough confidence to solve this. So pick up such kind of easy question, get the low hanging fruits, and then slowly you can move on to the higher level of difficulty. Hope you must have enjoyed this video.